الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. So جزاكم الله خير for coming to this program tonight. You're talking about, as announced before, financial justice with family members. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as you can see this ayah here, from Allah ya'muru bil 'adli wal ihsani wa ita'i dhil qurba. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yusi bil aqarib, silat al rahim, keeping the ties of kinship, is a great act of worship. So we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we take care of our family members, when we treat them with ihsan. And they are the most, actually more deserving of our kindness, our family members. When it comes to money issues, people sometimes disagree with each other, they have problems, and they don't treat each other in a nice way. Because you know, he is a human being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him in a very interesting way. We love money, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it part of our nature. And he told us this in the Quran, and it is a challenge. It is part of mujahada to fight your desires for the sake of establishing justice in your life as a human being, the family of your, in the life of your family members. And this is our topic tonight here. So al-'adl amru min awamir Allah azza wa jalla, iqamatu al-'adl fi al-ard. Wa qabla an nutalib, before we ask governments and leaders to establish justice in the land, we need to establish justice in our personal life and with our family members. Treat your wife the way you treat your wife, the way you treat your children, the way you divide your inheritance or you write your wasiya, your will. كما قال ابن عباس رضي الله عنه الإضرار في الوصية من الكبائر. So he said, ابن عباس رضي الله عنه, he said, oppression when writing your wasiya is a major sin. من الكبائر من كبائر الذنوب. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and يوفقنا لكل خير. So the content of this workshop will be talking about wasiya, the legal will, gifts to children. When we give gifts to children, what are the things that we need to pay attention to? And fairness with all children, child benefits in this country. There are sometimes, you know, people who, you know, have some disagreements, especially between husband and wife, about who will use the child benefit, who will keep it in his account, and who owns the child, this money coming from the government. We end up sometimes having problems and divorce and bigger issues. The wealth of our children doesn't belong to you. Do you own it as a father? And to Umar ibn al-Abid, there is a famous hadith, we need to understand this hadith. You and your wealth belong to your father. We need to understand this hadith and what the ulama said about it. So financial justice between husband and wife, family business, and fair dealing with employed family members. What is a wasiya? The ulama said, basically it is a legal declaration. Wathiqa qanuniya here. Wathiqa huquqiya. It's a legal declaration of how a person wishes for his and or her possessions to be disposed of after his death. So what do we include in the wasiya? We don't actually divide the inheritance because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has divided the inheritance. But it is part of it. In this country here, you need to include the division of your inheritance, or you refer to Surah An-Nisa, or you refer to the Islamic Center to do it. You know, there are different ways of writing this wasiya. But the wasiya in Islam, in Surah An-Nisa, is the bequest. When you bequeath, when you grant by will to someone else other than in the inheritors, Islamic organization, the Masjid, another family who is not supposed to inherit you. So this is the wasiya. Then we'll talk about, you know, the rulings and the requirements of this wasiya tonight, inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeated this ayah in Surah An-Nisa, مِنْ بَعْدِ وَصِيَّةٍ يُوصِي بِهَا أَوْدَيْنٍ. So what are the حُقُوقِ أَخْوَانٍ? What is the first haq when someone passes away? What is the first haq? Naam? Before the day. Before the day. What is the first right? Before was definitely the expenses of his janazah. And it has to be paid from his money. Unless some other family members want to pay on his behalf, that's okay. But the first right is the expenses are the expenses of his janazah. Sometimes it costs $5,000, $6,000, $7,000. I know a masjid in our city in Carmen, they charge $5,000 for a qabr. For digging a grave, they charge around $5,000. Actually, they offer other services, but it is a good amount of money. So this is the first right. And after the number two. Number one is the expenses of your janazah. Number two. A day, your debts, you have to, your family member, the inheritors have to pay your loans back to the creditors. So debt. And wasiyah is number three. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places the wasiyah before day in the Quran. Why? There is a reason. There is a reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will place a day all the time after wasiyah. But when it comes to giving priority to this different right, classifying these rights after the person passes away, we start with the expenses of janazah, then day. Your deen has to be, your debts have to be paid before wasiyah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places a deen in Surah An-Nisa after wasiyah. The ulama, they said, there is always someone who is looking, asking for his deen, right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed the wasiyah before a deen because he wanted people to pay attention to the wasiyah, not to neglect it. To give it some importance. It doesn't mean that we have to give it priority. Day is more important than the wasiyah. Day, your debts are more important. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed day after because He wanted to us to pay attention to the importance of wasiyah. Because day there is always someone who is, you know, who will ask for his debts to be paid back to him. So this wasiyah, the ulama they said is generally recommended, but it could be mandatory. It could be mandatory when someone has some financial obligations. If you have financial, you have some debts, you have a trust at home, someone gave you something, and you say, please, brother, I trust you, could you keep this money with you? He doesn't want to keep it in the bank. I mean, usually people keep their money in the bank. The time of Rasulullah, they didn't have banks. So they used to look for trustworthy people and leave their belongings with them. And that was the case with Rasulullah. That's why when he left Mecca, immigrating to Medina, when he was leaving to Medina, he left Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu behind him. One of the reasons is that he asked him, كَلَّفَهُ بِأَنْ يَرُدَ الْأَمَانَةَ الْأَمَانَةِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. He asked him to give his belongings to their homes in Mecca. So the ulama said it could be compulsory and obligatory when someone is bound with some financial obligations. Because there is a hadith here, a famous hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Bukhari and Muslim. يقول في هذا الحديث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما حق امرئ مسلم له شيء يوصي به يبيت ليلتين إلا ووصيته مكتوبة عنده. So he said it is not permissible for any Muslim who has something to will to stay for two nights without having his last will, a testament written and kept ready with him. If he has some financial obligations, as I said. But if he doesn't have, then it should be okay, it should be fine. And lack of documentation, ikhwan, might lead to highly complicated issues. Yeah, and there are people here who wrote their wasiyah when they passed away, it was easy for their family to divide whatever they left, wealth and money, cash in the bank or properties, it was easy for them because of this wasiyah, especially when it is certified by a lawyer or a notary public, it will be accepted by the government and the process will be very smooth and things will be easy. Other people did not leave a wasiyah. Their family members were able at the end to solve the problems, but they went through some difficulties. So you need to think about it. Living in this country, it's not a Muslim country, right? But when you have your own wasiyah, usually I talked to a non-Muslim lawyer, and he told me that wills have a universal nature. That means any will should be accepted in any court of law. Because it's your will, it's your wish. We have our own will sometimes, our wills in our Islamic centers. And there are some lawyers who will look at the division of the inheritance, and they might tell you that this is not in line with what we have here in Canada, with Canadian laws. But they don't have the right to force you to change your will. They don't have the right. And actually some lawyers, another lawyer who is a Christian, is a person who is religious. He's not Muslim. He looked at our will, the Islamic will, and he was very impressed the way the Islamic Sharia has divided the inheritance. So anyway, no one will force you, no lawyer. They might tell you, they might make a comment, and they tell you, this is not in compliance with Canadian laws or something like that. But they don't have the right to tell you to change it. You need to follow Surah An-Nisa. When it comes to the division of inheritance, you need to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have no other choice. And we'll talk about some problems, some of the issues, some of the stories that I know. People went against the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when dividing their inheritance. This is one of the requirements. The donations of the wasiyah cannot be given to the inheritors. Allah Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yaqul, inna Allah a'ta kulli dhi haqqin haqqahu fala wasiyata li warith. So he said, Allah has given each rightful person their right. You go to Surah An-Nisa, everyone has his own right, right? Plus the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned some other rights. So he said, there is no bequest in favor of one of the inheritors. Except in one case, if all of them agree. All of them agree and they said, it's okay. This is our mother. She's one of the inheritors. If you want to make a wasiyah, an extra wasiyah for our mother, that's okay, we're fine with that. But all the children have to be adults, same adults. If someone is mentally challenged, or one of them is a minor, then this is not possible. Because they have to have the legal capacity to sign or to agree or to approve this arrangement. And a minor doesn't have, a young child doesn't have this legal capacity. Or someone who is mentally challenged doesn't have this legal capacity. So, it is only permissible in one case if all the inheritors are fine with it, they approve it, and all of them are same adults. The second condition, the ulama, they said, this donation cannot exceed the third of your wealth. Because of the famous story of Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu, in Hajj al-Wada', he was very sick. Very sick. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to visit him in Mecca. He was in Mecca. فَقَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ قَدْ رَأَيْتَ مَا حَلَّبِي. You know what I'm going through. I'm very sick. And I have only one daughter who will inherit my property or my wealth. He was very wealthy. He said, I'm very wealthy and I have only one daughter. I'm not sure if his wife was alive at the time. But he mentioned his daughter in this hadith, right? So he said, he asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, هَلْ أَتَبَرَّعُ بِثُلُثَيْ مَالِي. Do you think I should donate two-thirds of my wealth? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no. And then he said, وَالنِّصْف. وَمَاذَا عَنِ النِّصْف. فَالنَّبِي sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how about half of my wealth? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no. How about the third of my wealth? This is Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas asking Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam قال الثلث والثلث كثير. نعم وافق على الثلث. He said yes, even though the third is still a big amount. Then he made a comment, لأن تدع ورثتك أغنياء أفضل من أن تدعهم فقراء يتكففون الناس بعد موتك. He said if you leave your family members rich and wealthy is better than leaving them, you know, poor and in need, and then they will end up asking help from other people after your death, after you pass away. So the ulama, we're able to derive some rulings from this hadith here. The first ruling is, this wasiyah cannot exceed the thuluth, which is the third of your wealth, which is 33% basically. It has to be less than 33% if you want to give, make a wasiyah to a masjid, to an Islamic school, to some other family members who are not inheritors. Your aunt or your cousin, they don't inherit you, you know, or some orphans. So you can bequest for these people, you can bequeath for these people, grant them by will, but it cannot exceed a thuluth. The second ruling, the ulama, they said if the person is faqir, the person is poor, his financial means are very limited, then it is makruh for him to make this will. He should leave everything for his family. If someone is faqir, but if someone is wealthy, so then it is recommended, he is recommended to make this wasiyah. Wallahu ta'ala. So these are basically the rules here, general conditions. No more than a third, it becomes permissible if the heirs approve it and they are saying adults. No wasiyah from the third to any of the inheritors. And it is makruh to bequeath if the person is not wealthy. These are the general rulings that we can derive from this hadith and these stories. When it comes to the inheritance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has divided the inheritance. He did not leave it to our desires or our own, you know, ishtihad. Because if we left it to our own desire, we will create a mess. And we will commit zulm. And we'll favor some family members upon other family members, right? Over other family members. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows our nature. So, and then he called them, after, if you go to Surah An-Nisa, after mentioning all these rulings, he said, تِلْكَ حُدُودُ اللَّهِ. These are the limits of Allah. But yet, there are some people who are crossing these limits. I know someone, a family, where the father decided to give the whole wealth to his boys. And he denied his girls from inheritance. And they told me about the story, it's a very painful story. And the girls decided to sue their brothers. And it's a case in the court for the last 10, 15 years. It's very painful when they meet during Eid, their meeting, their gathering is not a happy gathering. It's poisonous. Because they are having disagreement. These boys should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and change this wasiyah. Yes, this is the ruling. All the ulama, they said when the wasiyah is balima, the wasiyah ja'ir, when there is oppression, when it contains oppression, it should be changed. It cannot be executed by any courts of law. And the family members, they know that this is dhulm, because this is against the laws and the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. These boys should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and make this adjustment, this correction. And it is if they want to benefit their father, because their father will be taken to account for this decision. He's the one who made this decision. There are people who advised him. I'm talking about this specific case here. The people who advised him, and he said, you know, this is haram, you shouldn't do it. And his answer was, I know what I'm doing. Now, he left a big mess in the family. Family members do not talk to each other. They have problems, they have issues, and girls are taking their own brothers to the court. So this is a mess. And Umar Khattab radiallahu anhu made a very beautiful standing pledge. He used to make a dua. This dua was attributed to Umar Khattab. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min mali wa hasabu alayhi fi qabri wa yantafi'u bihi ghayri. Oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from a wealth that I will be taken to account for it, but others will benefit from it. So other family members will benefit from this wealth, but you, the owner of this wealth, because of your wrong decisions, maybe the way you earn this wealth, the way you spend it, the way you wrote your wasiyah, you'll be taken to account for this wealth. But someone else will enjoy it. And they will not be taken to account for using this wealth or spending it. They will not. But the person who made the decision will be taken to account. So when it comes to these things, ikhwan, we cannot change the laws of inheritance. We cannot change them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls them the limits. These are the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is a threat here. There is a glad tidings for the one who obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, Allah will admit him into gardens of paradise in which rivers flow eternally and abiding eternally therein. People, it's a great achievement. It's a great success, ya ikhwan, to earn the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enter Jannah. And then he said in the next ayah, whoever disobeys Allah, he's talking about laws of inheritance. وَمَنْ يَعْصِ اللَّهِ Whoever disobeys Allah and His Messenger and transgresses His limits. He's talking about the limits of inheritance. What will happen? We'll send him into the fire of hell. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala salamat wa rahim. You tell me he's still Muslim? Yes, he's still Muslim. But there are some Muslims who will go to hellfire and then they will end up leaving the hellfire and go to Jannah because of their tawheed. But entering hellfire for one day or two or three is not a joke. It's not a joke. So this is a big risk that we take if we change the laws of inheritance. Wallahu ta'ala. And this is very common, ikhwan. Very common. Now there is another problem. There are people who like to divide their wealth during their life. So now you cannot call it inheritance. They are given gifts. Or if they do it now with the intention of dividing the inheritance before they pass away. Islamically is not called inheritance, but it is permissible to do it even though it is highly disliked. Because of some issues, because the ulama said, I want to disagree. If you divide your wealth when you're still alive, are you going to follow the laws of inheritance? If you have children, boys and girls, are you going to give the boys double, two shares, and one girl, each girl one share? Let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يُسِيكُمُ اللَّهُ فِي أَوْلَادِكُمْ لِذَكَرِ مِثْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنثَيَيْنِ. Let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran that you give two shares to your child. Not every male in the family will get two shares and all the other ladies or girls will get one share. Now, there are ladies who will inherit more than the male members in the family. If he's an uncle, for example. If someone died and left an uncle from his father's side, and a daughter and a wife. The daughter will take half, and the wife will take the eighth of the inheritance. And the uncle here is a male member from the family, but he will inherit less than the daughter, and maybe less than the wife. So it's not, there are people who believe that whenever there is a male member from the family, then he will have to take two shares and the lady will take only one share. This is not right. But when we talk about children, yes. This Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يُسِيكُمُ اللَّهُ فِي أَوْلَادِكُمْ. This wasiyah is about children. So when you have children, you have three boys and two girls. For example, that in the Quran, every boy will take two shares and every girl will take one share. Now, when it comes to dividing your inheritance when you are still alive, are you going to follow the laws of inheritance? We give everyone the same. You divide it with complete justice. I mean, even the other way is justice because it's the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? But the problem here, there is a disagreement between scholars. Some of them, they said, you follow because you're still alive. It's not inheritance. It's like you're giving gifts to your family. So you, some of them, they said, you follow the laws of inheritance. Others, they said, no, you have to give everyone the same. Regardless if they are males or females. Now, by what I feel, I strongly believe that if someone is doing it with the intention of dividing his inheritance before he passes away, because there are people who do it because they are worried about what will happen after he passes away. He knows his family members don't have a good relationship. Like here in Canada, if you write a will and it is certified by a lawyer, most likely they will not be able to change it. But then we're talking about Muslim communities in general. Back home, here, everywhere. I mean, we have families, we have properties back home, and we deal with our family members, whether here in Canada or somewhere else. Now, if the person has the intention to divide his inheritance, because he doesn't want his family members to fight, to have some disagreements after he passes away, if he's doing it with this intention, he should follow Allah Ta'ala and the laws of inheritance. But the Quran says, but the way of dividing the inheritance. But if he is giving gifts, say, I want to give gifts to my family, give them money. I don't need this money. I want my children to benefit from it now. Then it's okay for him if he gives everyone the same thing. Like girls and boys, give them the same thing. Allah Ta'ala. Give everyone $10,000, for example. But there are people who divided their money, their wealth, before they passed away. Because they were sick and they thought that they would die. But Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala cured their sickness. And they lived for a long period of time. But they regretted that decision. Because their own family members, their children did not take care of them. Their children did not take care of them. He gave them everything. And they regretted that decision. So anyway, one of us has to think about it before taking this decision. There's one thing that is really important. They said if someone divides his wealth before he passes away with the intention of depriving some family members from their shares of inheritance, then this is another problem here, and it is a sin. And Allah knows, only Allah knows what is in your heart and what is in my heart. Because there are people who said, I have only daughters, and I have my wife, and I have my brother, who is their uncle, right? And he doesn't want his brother to take from the inheritance. He wants everything to go to his wife and daughters. But if he passes away, his own brother has a right in his property. Okay, but he doesn't want his brother to benefit from this wealth. So he would do what? He would dispute everything before he dies, like a gift. And his brother doesn't have the right to complain, right? If he does it with this intention, and Allah knows the intention of every human being on earth, then it is a sin. And it is a major sin. Because هذا وجه من أوجه الإضرار في الوصية. العلماء يقولون, committing oppression when writing your will. This is one form of committing oppression or doing injustice when writing a will of Allah Ta'ala. Now, when giving gifts, and here we're talking about significant gifts. We're not talking about small gifts. We're not talking about sandwich, we're not talking about watch, we're not significant gifts. If a parent is giving a gift to his child, then he has to treat all the children with justice. He has to give the same to the rest of the children. I'm talking about gifts, no inheritance, just gifts. Right? What is the proof? Is the hadith of Nu'man ibn Bashir. He said, ask him to witness this donation, this gift. He's giving his son, right? So Rasulullah said, do you have other children? He said, yes. Did you give them the same? He said, no. He said, that tushhidni ala jawr. Jawr yani dhulm. He said, I cannot witness an act of injustice. And then in another version, he said, اتقوا الله واعدلوا بين أولادكم. اتقوا الله واعدلوا بين fear Allah and treat all your children with justice. So when you give one of your children a gift, he doesn't need it. Like he's not going to university and he needs to pay the fees. He's not someone who needs to get married. Right? And he needs the expenses of his marriage. He's not someone in need, because when there is need is different, we'll talk about it. But you just give him a gift, you love this child, he's very obedient, very nice, you know, he knows how to communicate with his parents, okay, in a nice way. And you like him, right? And you want to give him a gift and leave the rest of the children. You know, I lived in Yemen in the 90s, in the middle of the 90s. I lived in Yemen for 1 year. And when I was in that area, I was teaching there in the school. I heard a very painful story in the same area. A very painful story. Someone who was favoring some of his children, and he was neglecting one of his children. He was a man, married, has children. And, you know, he had a very bad relationship with his father. Very bad relationship. So one time, he met his father in the market. And he did not treat his father with kindness. He was very harsh with his father in front of other people. So his father, he said something very bad to his father. His father became very angry. And they were talking in front, having these arguments. They went and they stood up in front of his house, right? The house of the father. They were having arguments and screaming to each other. The father went inside the house. He took his clashing coat and he killed his son. His own son. And subhanAllah, you know, it's a crime, right? It went to the court. The judge passed his decree upon the father to give his wife and his children a piece of land. A big piece of land. And the people were saying, subhanAllah, if he gave him this piece of land when he was alive, he would not commit a crime. He would not kill his own son. He would have earned his mahabbah, his love. And he would have fixed all his problems with his son. Right? Because now he's forced, now the judge is forcing him to give his family this big piece of land as a blood money. So, do not discriminate against your own children. Treat them with justice. Even when it comes to kissing, ikhwan. Al-adala fi taqbeel. Sometimes you kiss one of your children, right? The other one is looking. Do you think he's not observing? He's not affected? Even young children notice if you favor one of them, and you take care of one of them, and you neglect others, they feel it. And it stays inside. And it might have an influence over your relationship, when they grow up, therefore. So even when you kiss your children and you play with them, try to be just and fair to Allah Ta'ala. When it comes to fulfillment of needs, as I said, it's a different issue. If someone, one of your children needs some help, you are allowed to give him and fulfill his needs. Like someone going to university, it doesn't happen. The other children are working, they graduated, they're doing well. This child is still going to university, that he needs your help, then that's okay, you can give him. You don't have to give the same amount of money to the other children. Because you're not giving a gift, you're fulfilling what? A need. Marriage expenses, same thing, or school fees, or anything. Now, there is another problem. There are people, and it's very common in some communities, people who fulfill the needs of their children when they're going to school, getting married, for example, or the guy lost his job and he doesn't have an income. And you give him some money to help him, right, to survive for his family. So you're fulfilling a need. So what they do, he was studying at the university, I paid all his fees, and that was the amount of around $20,000, for example, dollars. What they do, at the time of writing the will, they try to discount this amount from the inheritance. So they try to make an adjustment. I gave him $20,000 for his university fees. Now when I want this $20,000 to be taken away from the share of inheritance, when I pass away, and this is not right, this is wrong. Because you were helping him, you were fulfilling a need, you don't need to do this adjustment. If another child has another problem and he needed help, you need to help them too. So you don't need to do this adjustment at the time of dividing the inheritance. Don't try to do the ruling. Wallahu ta'ala alam. This is the fatwa of many qualified scholars. Now there is a famous hadith. Anta wa maluka li abik. You and your wealth belong to your father. This is a hadith, Hassan. The ulama, they said it has many chain of narration. And it is hadith Hassan, so it is accepted and we need to pay attention to it. But anta wa maluka li abik, it doesn't mean that your wealth belongs to your father. Allah huna al-ulama yaqulu lil-ibaha, yani your father is allowed to use your money at times of need, but with some conditions. With some conditions that you don't hurt your child. If he is in need of this money, you don't take it from him. Why? He needs to survive. He has family and he has a limited income. You cannot take his money, use it for your own self, and hurt your effect on the survival of your own child, right? You can't do that. So this is number one. Number two, you don't take this money from one child and give it to another child. You don't do that. But if the father needs some help, if he needs some help, he's allowed to take from the wealth from his child. Wallahu ta'ala ala, based on this hadith. Wallahu ta'ala. When it comes to child benefits, the government here, therefore, is giving us child benefits to spend them on our children. So there is no need to dispute, to have an argument about these child benefits. But if you mix them with your monthly budget, spend them on the family, that's okay. That's fine. There is no problem with that. If you save them for the children, for their education, that's okay. There are families who agree on that, said, let's keep this money on the side, save it for the children. When they grow up, go to university, we give it to them, they will use it for their own education. That's fine. But if you spend it, you mix it with your monthly expenses, and you spend it to the family, that should be fine. Wallahu ta'ala. When it comes to women, we have some common problems here, and we deal with them, these problems in our Islamic centers, in our masajid. Jumhur ulama, or other ulama, kullum, taqreeban, there is a small disagreement with the Maliki madhab. Imam Malik will talk about it now. But most of the majority of scholars, they said that women, they believe women are financially independent. That means if she works, if she's making money, it's her money, you don't have the right to tell her, you don't own your money, you give me your check. If she wants to give you a check, give you her salary, that's okay, if it is her choice and decision. But you cannot force her to give you her salary. And this is something that some brothers don't like, you know, but this is our deen, yeah. We have to be honest and we have to be frank about it. Now there is a disagreement between Imam Malik and majority of scholars when it comes to donating more than the third of her money, donating. Imam Malik believes that she has to take permission from her husband. The Jumhur ulama said that she doesn't need to take permission, it's her money. If she wants to give sadaqah, give zakat. But what most of the scholars say, it is nice if she talks to her husband and let him know she does it with his blessing. It's nice. It will create more, it will increase love in the family. Her husband will feel that he's respected, that his wife is, you know, consulting him, talking to him about their financial matters. Wallahu ta'ala. Now, when it comes to contributing to the monthly budget, here's the problem. And the problem arises at the time of divorce. There are women who help with the monthly expenses on a regular basis. They pay the bills, they pay sometimes for the mortgage, they pay for other things, right? Now, the decision of our scholars in North America, they said that she has to decide if there is a difference between donating your money decides to donate this money to the family, right? To contribute without making any agreement with the husband. She doesn't tell him, this is a loan. When your income increases, whenever you have more money, you give me this money back. Return this money to me. This is my money. I'm not helping, I'm giving you a loan. Because it's his responsibility to spend on the family. Right? It is his responsibility. She can do that and she has a right to do that. It's not nice. Most of the women don't do it. Don't do it. They donate their money to the family, they contribute, right? The problem is at the time of divorce, many of them, they said, I used to pay the bills, I used to do this, I used to do this, I need my money now. At the time of divorce. So the ulama now here in North America, and this is accepted and this is what we are following, we distinguish between regular contribution, which is paying for food, for shelter, for food, for clothing, for monthly expenses, and real estate, properties. If she's contributing into the payment of a business, she's establishing a business with her husband, or buying a property, she has the right in this property. And the husband doesn't have the right to take her money. It's her money. She contributed into buying this property. He doesn't have the right to take. So they distinguish between real estate properties, immovable properties, and between food, payment for food and for bills and for other, daily expenses. If she didn't have an agreement in this area with her husband, then it is a tabarru', it is a donation, and she doesn't have the right to ask for this money at the time of divorce. But she has the right to ask for her money that she contributed into buying a property or establishing a business. So you see the difference here, ikhwan? And this will solve the problem. Alhamdulillah, and many women at the time of divorce are happy with that. If they contributed, into properties, at least they get some money back. Wallahu ta'ala. Okay, now, what time is it? So 10 after 9. We're supposed to finish at 9:30. If you have questions, we can discuss them now, maybe that time. And there is an announcement about, we're doing a seminar tomorrow in Mac Center. And it will be about Islamic finance, fiqh and business transactions. So we'll talk about the classical matters of fiqh in the area of mu'amalat al-maliyah, financial matters, the classical principles of fiqh. And then we'll talk about some modern products in the market, like housing, like RESP, RSP, cryptocurrencies, and all these things that are new, in the financial market. This seminar will start at 9 o'clock. I'll finish myself at 2:30. There is someone else who will come. His name is Khalid Sultan, he's from Toronto. And he will be talking about some investments that are called halal by some scholars, but my job is to explain, give you the fiqh background, and be honest with you and tell you, the reality of this investment. Some people said it's halal, some people said it's haram. I have to explain to you, this is my job, cannot lie to you. But his job is to explain the products that we have. I think he works with CIBC, and they have a department for mutual funds based on Islamic guidelines, wallahu ta'ala. But he's not coming to talk about on behalf of CIBC. To the best of my knowledge, actually Mark brought him to talk about this kind of investment in Canada. And it is an option, we'll talk about it, but it's not something that is agreed upon by all scholars. We'll talk about it tomorrow, inshallah, being the night time. So if you have a question, go ahead. Come on, Isha. If they agree, for you to exceed the third in your wasiyah, and all of them are adults and they are sane, they are not mentally, no one is mentally challenged, They're healthy, they're sane, and they are adults. No one is minor. So no child among them. So they agreed, they approved. They said, okay, we can make a wasiyah for 40% or 50% of your wealth. That's okay. Or if you make a wasiyah to one of the inheritors. Because inheritors don't have a right to be included in the wasiyah unless all the inheritors agree and approve it. Okay?
Country, it's very difficult for intergenerational wealth to stay with the family. Example, a businessman is or businesswoman is successful. The children, they don't want to get in the business, but they get the benefit of the wealth of the parent. And by the third generation, they're just squandering the money because they just don't have the smarts. They didn't want to work in the family business. So there is a practice of creating a family trust that the following generations of a successful person, professional or business person, the money goes into the trust, and the children or the following generations, they don't actually own anything. They can borrow from the trust, or it's they live in a house owned by the trust. So this is a way to prevent the poverty of future generations, that okay. It happens.
Yeah.
Is this permissible? Is this permissible for us?
It is actually highly encouraged in our Islamic Sharia. It's highly encouraged. We call it wealth. And a person is allowed to create a wealth for his own family. Right? So his family members or descendants will benefit from it. It's not a common practice within Muslim communities, maybe because of lack of education. We don't talk about wealth. Wealth is used to in Islamic history, a huge institution. And many different groups used to benefit from this awqaf. But actually what happened is, in the modern era, Muslim governments, or these governments in Muslim countries, they are the ones who killed this concept. Because they transferred ownership of this awqaf to the Ministry of Religious Affairs. And we don't know exactly. If you go to any Muslim country, we don't know what happened to these properties. And the public, they don't know, they have no access to this knowledge, right? In some countries, yes, there are some awqaf, there are people who are still benefiting from this awqaf, this trust, but this is a good idea, beautiful idea. If a Muslim is wealthy, and he has this intention to establish, you know, a trust for his family, then go ahead and do it. It's good, it's nice. And of course, you know, a wealth, when you establish a wealth and you donate money, your money, it becomes, it's not your property anymore. You cannot benefit from it as a person. So the beneficiaries, the other people, will benefit from it. And of course, you know, you need to, in this country, maybe you have to assign a lawyer to take care of your wealth, right? A trust, right? So in our Muslim countries, we used to have another wealth. Okay, someone, wealth manager, and they used to be given salaries. It was a huge institution within Muslim societies in the past. And even non-Muslims used to believe from this awqaf. If you read books of history, read the story book, you know how Muslims were, mashallah, dividing wealth and making everyone happy, especially in the medieval ages when we had a very strong civilization. Nowadays, as I said, maybe lack of education is a factor. That's why we don't know about this kind of things. But it is highly encouraged in Islam and wealth. And it started from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first one I think who made wealth was Umar ibn Khattab, if I'm not mistaken. And then the rest of the Sahaba, they started making awqaf, and it became a practice, a common practice within Muslim societies. Yes. Tradition. The money that is donated to the masjid by default is a wealth. Any money that comes to the masjid. The masjid itself is a wealth. But if you want to create a trust to maintain the masjid, well, it's good. It's something beautiful. It's good. And I think we should do it. Yeah, the Islamic organization has to think about these things. Instead of asking that man. Yeah, it is. The brother is saying it's permissible. I know for a fact it's permissible. You can do it. You just have to work with good lawyers and you do it. Yeah, I mean, it's not difficult. It is serious. Now?
The
31
years?
21.
Yeah.
Here in Canada?
Yeah.
Okay. After 21 years, what will happen to the trust? Now? You lose it. Okay, now we are Muslims, and we have our own yani, laws and regulations. So we can talk to the boys and see if we can have some exceptions, right? Yeah, if we can discuss with the lawyers and say, you know, awqaf in our deen, in our religion, stay forever. You don't have a limited time. Something you can negotiate with some lawyers and you can find a way. There's always a way to do things. Now, yes. Fadal issue. Consider.
And then let's say
So the problem is solved. No, the likelihood After 21 years, the trustees, the people who are taking care of the trust, right? Yeah, and who is the trustee in this case? The lawyer or any group of people who were assigned as trustees? Okay, and you take the money if there is no beneficiary. All of them die, but they can take the money. Okay. It's a different story here. Fine. Jazakumullah khair. Barakallahu feekum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless your time. Jazakumullah khair for coming. And we invite you to come tomorrow, inshallah. We're talking about a different issue. About Islamic fiqh. Islamic finance. Fiqh of business transactions, inshallah. And business transactions in general, being like that. So again, we talk about the classical principles in the area of fiqh, and then we'll talk about some modern transactions and modern products that are found in the market nowadays. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum. I just want to say, if anybody is interested in buying the tickets for tomorrow, they can contact me. Or if you want to go online and buy it, you can go to macvancouver.ca and buy your tickets online as well, inshallah. Zakalab here.